Today, we have the fourth Small Talks and Big Ideas we've ever had, and we've transitioned into Zoom to make it accessible for everyone, for you guys at home too in quarantine. And today we have a very special guest. It's Aisha Ann Hakim, who has been nominated top 30 most creative women, one show judge, and also entrepreneur of the app Fellow. A very accomplished senior art director at Venables Bell. So let's give it up for Aisha.
Hi guys. Thank you for those virtual claps. Felix has been trying to track me down for a while, and now that I'm in quarantine, I have no excuses. So here I am. I'm hoping to just talk a little bit about my journey, and hopefully that can give you guys some tools and advice you need as you kind of are entering the industry, because I definitely had a bit of a non-traditional path. And I think that where I've been able to get to today, I just think I have a lot to offer in terms of, you know, what the right things to do in the industry that are beyond just like having a great book and showing up every day. Like, I think it's much more complex than that. So I'm going to talk about a few of my favorite pieces, which I'm going to show, and touch on how COVID-19 has kind of affected the industry so far. I think that, a month from now, things could look very different in terms of how the industry is being affected by all this. But I can kind of talk about things that I've encountered so far and how I see it continuing to impact the industry. And then you guys can ask questions at the end if you have them. So, how I got into the industry. This will be relevant and not, because I did not go to ad school. It's very shocking. I'm one of the few people who didn't go to ad school. I think that that was helpful in ways. I think that that was very unhelpful in ways. I think that ad school can provide so many connections and kind of a leg up in terms of knowing what to expect when you get into the industry. So when I got into it, I had no idea what anything was or the political dynamic of the industry. I didn't know who Wieden and Kennedy was. I didn't know why we should care about them. And so I definitely learned from the ground up, which I think was challenging in ways, but I also think gave me a really clear perspective in terms of the best way to put yourself forward to kind of rise in the industry. So I can kind of go into a little bit more detail and try to make this interesting for you all. A little TRDL on me, I went to school for graphic design. I was a bad student in high school. I got D's, C's, F's. I was always artistic though. I just didn't understand how to learn, I think, when I was in high school. And so I'd get bad grades. And so I just didn't think I was smart. And I went through life being like, well, I hope I can be creative because, you know, I really have nothing else going for me. So when everyone else went off to college, I was literally waitressing at a pizza joint in my hometown for the first semester, applied to art school, got in, went to Boston, was blown away, just re-fell in love with creativity all over again. I only stayed 2 years because my dad had a health issue, and so I had to move home. So I ended up being home at 21 with no proper education. Although I had been in school for 2 years, it was kind of like introductory art class program. So it was a lot of like painting, drawing, collage. It was nothing that I could really use to transfer into the world. Like, I was still learning Adobe and all that stuff. So I just didn't really have very many options. So I was waitressing. And I put together a little book of drawings and stuff that I'd done. And I went to a local publishing company, and my hometown was like 25,000 people. So when I say local publishing company, I really mean like a very little local magazine and paper. And I walked in, and I had a book with me, and I asked where the creative director was, and they said there. And I just told him that I would work for free for as long as it would take for them to hire me and to believe that I could contribute. And I think that, and they did. And so after a month, I worked for free for a month. And actually he was like, okay, sit down at the computer. And so I sat down and he had me design two, well, I thought I was doing advertising. He had me design two ads, two newspaper ads, one for a Mexican restaurant and one for a hotel. And so I did those two and he was like, okay, you can stay. And I think that's like such a boomer story for to be like, just go down to your local shop and give and show me up the right stuff. So I acknowledge that, like, because I was in a hometown, in my hometown, and it was small, there wasn't a lot of competition. But I do think that that attitude of I will do whatever it takes and I don't care how low I have to start was something that is still carrying me through. And I think that I was able to rise really quickly because of that attitude. And when I see other people or I've worked with other people who have maybe felt a little bit more privileged in terms of the type of projects that they felt they wanted, you know, where it's like, oh, I won't do banner ads, or I won't do this, or I won't write that YouTube copy at the bottom of the video. I think that that's the wrong way to think about things, because this kind of scrappy attitude of just like, I'll do whatever it takes has really helped me. So then did that. That was fine. Hated it. My dad knew someone who worked at an Ocean in Huntington Beach. They do Hyundai. And she said, you can come up there and poke around and ask questions, because he was like, I knew it was creative and he knew I was creative. So he knew that they were connected somehow. And so I went up and I just immediately thought it was so cool. Like, the agency was on the water, like literally beachfront. It had its own cafe. There was like art on the walls. And Ocean at the time was actually doing some really cool work. They had just shot a spot with Wes Anderson, or two spots with Wes Anderson, and were doing some really conceptual work at the front of kind of when they started to become a little bit more serious about Hyundai's brand, after they had left Goodby, or they had left Goodby, and then I think they were trying to kind of rebrand. So And Ocean was helping with that. And again, I just loved it and was like, I think this is so cool. And I didn't even really know what advertising was, but I just wanted to be there. Because I just loved how public it was and how the platform it provided. So I'm probably rambling, but I'm just going to continue on. So similar to my story of just walking in and being like, I'll do whatever it takes. I met with some creative directors and they were just kind of like, yeah, you're cute. Like, good job. Keep doing what you're doing. I was so far, I didn't have a book. I was so far away from the type of juniors they hired that, you know, I think that they just humored me because I was a friend of a friend. But I ended up stalking them until they gave me an internship, and really wanted, it was a 3-month internship in the summer, and similar thing. I just was like super scrappy. I just, whatever they asked me to do, I just tried to do it way beyond what they expected me to deliver. And I think that that's something that I tell a lot of juniors and a lot of young women in the industry, which is like, you already stand out, and also people expect nothing of you. And so that's actually an amazing situation to be in, because every single thing you do, you can surprise someone with what you've delivered. So you can over-deliver every single time because they expect nothing from you. And so I think that's actually kind of a powerful position. And so they ended up bringing me back permalanced for 2 years. So it was a grind to get them to hire me back. But again, similar of like being really, really, really hungry. I didn't have a partner and there was a Super Bowl brief floating around. And so I was like, oh, I have no fucking idea how to write Super Bowl. I have no idea how to write TV. So I'll just ask for the brief and just like write some spots and show them to my creative director. And, you know, he can help me because, again, nothing is expected of me. The bar is the floor. That's a great place to be when the bar is the floor. So I had some ideas and I wrote up some scripts, and I showed them my creative director and he was like, these don't suck. All right, we will get you a writer and we'll brief you properly. And I sold a Super Bowl spot that year. So, first spot ever, sold a Super Bowl spot. I see the process very differently in retrospect now, since we were so junior. We weren't very involved in the production. Like, we were, but now I look back and it was like very, polite that they were, like, my creative directors were allowing us to stay involved. But no, it was amazing. And I think that was just, I think that that's kind of what will end up kind of undoing me, because I hit such a high so early in my career, that I've kind of just have been chasing that ever since. Like, I know we had a Super Bowl party, and like when the spot played, and it's not even that good of a spot played, and like everyone cheered, and I was just like, this is the pinnacle of human achievement, like I've made it. But that's kind of a tough bar to set early on. So I've gotten really, really close to having two Super Bowl spots. The agency recommend 2 years for Audi, and one of the spots I'm going to show you was cut from the Super Bowl 2 days before the Super Bowl, because people were, our music house came back and said that they were too close to Hans Zimmer, and so we might get sued. That was very heartbreaking. So that's how I got into the industry. That's kind of a condensed version. So then once I did the Super Bowl spot, that was a huge piece for my book, obviously. And that was allowing me to get my job at Venables in San Francisco, which is where I've been for 4.5 years. And that's kind of where I've really grown up and had the majority of my career here. But I've really tried to maintain that that personality trait that I had early on, even with the publishing company and, you know, getting into Notion. I think being annoying is kind of one of the best things you can do. I know it feels really, really wrong, but if I had just sat back and hoped, you know, the person who I met with at an ocean initially would remember me and maybe contact me if there was an internship open, I would have never gotten this far. And so people are in their own minds, they're in their own worlds, they're not thinking about you. And so anything you can do to stay top of mind. And I think even now that when I talk to juniors, the best thing you can do is do side projects that will try to get you noticed on social. I think that's a huge thing that I've also heard from, you know, talking to women like Colleen DeCourcy at Wyden, how they hire juniors. They, getting people's attention in whatever way that means, in whatever way reflects who you are and the type of work you want to do. And I know that that's kind of a mushy, vague brief, but I think that's something important to think about as you kind of not only look at your book, but look at how you act in the digital and social world, because that's a huge kind of networking opportunity for people. That's how I got into the industry. So career path. So then I got to Venables. I was extremely underprepared because I had not gone to ad school, and I had hustled my way into the production company, and I had publication company, and I'd hustled my way into an ocean. So I know virtually nothing, but I have a Super Bowl spot, so people think I know stuff. This is a very bad situation to be in. It was hard. It was really hard, and I struggled. I was on Reebok at the beginning, and I'm going to show you a spot that I did there. And I was doing so poorly that I got pulled aside by my ACD, who had the best of intentions. And he was just like, you know what? Reebok's a really hard client, and I totally understand if you don't want to work on it anymore. It's not for everyone. And, you know, it's totally cool. They're very difficult. It's okay to fail at this. And I was just like, read you loud and clear. And I'm very motivated by that, because I feel like someone who didn't graduate from college, you know, who didn't get good grades, I feel like I have a lot to prove. And I think that's part of the combination that's allowed me to kind of advance relatively quickly, because I want to overproduce. And so after that, I just busted my ass and ended up producing one of my favorite spots for Reebok, which I'll show you guys. And so from there, I don't know if we should break it up and show the spots. I can talk about how I got into Fellow, the networking app for women. Thoughts, questions?
Maybe we could show the, I think you could show the spots now, so we get like some context, and then
sure. Maybe we can have some questions. Okay, so first I'm going to show you guys driverless. This is my favorite spot. This is actually the director's cut, so it's a little bit different than what we did at the agency. This is the spot that got pulled 2 days before the Super Bowl. It would have been so good. So I will show you guys this. This is... this was my second spot with Audi. We shot it with Craig Gillespie, who shot I, Tanya. He had just gotten off They just wrapped Itanya and we had seen it. And it was one of the coolest experiences of my life because he really wanted to talk about it. And so as an art director, and he worked in advertising actually, Craig Gillespie started out as an art director in New York. And he would just be like, oh yeah, me and Margot, blah, blah, blah. And I'd be like, okay, so how did you shoot the shot where like the camera went over Margot and she was ice skating? And he just wanted to talk all about it. So it was basically the coolest experience of my entire life. So this is driverless.
Evening, Claire. Home, please.
Going home. Seem a little distracted, David.
You ever wonder? Never mind.
David, what's on your mind?
I was just thinking of a different time, is all.
Always reminding me.
It was a time when I used to sit up there, you know. Used to use my own hands, my own eyes. You wander down the lane. And driving wasn't just about being taken from place to place. Going somewhere. That will not die. Feeling something along the way.
Love is now the stardust.
Please, David, let me help you relax.
I'm afraid that's just the problem.
David, where are you going?
Sometimes I wonder why I spend the lonely night dreaming of a song.
So if I close this, right? Oh. Okay, so that was Driverless. My one beef with that director's cut is that the car actually is so loud and they minimized the, like that was one of the coolest parts to me and they really made it very light and I was shocked by that. Okay, and now I'm gonna show you the Reebok spot, 26,000 days that I shot after they almost kicked me off the account. So I'm still getting used to Zoom, please hold. Okay.
While I try my best, hey, to cover our eyes, it's a common way to blame and hide the truth. Never get old.
Okay, so funny story about that. So the director was my age, which was terrifying. And then also we were this scene where you polar plunge. So I'm standing out. Where there's like a crew guy next to me and it's like the sun's rising and he was like, and this is a polar plunge scene. So everyone has to dive completely under the water. And he was like, shallowest waters in North America. You can walk out for a mile and it won't even hit your knee. And I was like, so then how are we gonna polar plunge? And he was like, I don't know. I'm just like the grip guy. So I was like, okay. So then we had to make all these people dive into like a foot of water face first. Advertising is so weird. And then my third favorite piece of work is another Audi spot. This is called Final Breath. We shot this with Martin Datura, who is one of my favorite directors. And this one was a fun one because we got to shoot in Mexico City and then drive out of Mexico City into a town called Puebla. And we were in this old retired hacienda of this, you know, millionaire from the early 1900s, and it was another crazy experience. So this is Laughter.
I've spent my life in motion. Relentlessly pushing forward. Head first into the unknown. I've accepted every challenge. Hobnobbed with royalty. Stood beside legends. I've loved and lost. Learned to love again. I've squeezed every drop of juice out of this life. I'm ready for the next one.
Those are my three favorite spots. Let me figure out how to share my initial screen again. Okay, so yeah, so those are my three favorite spots. I've been really lucky to make a ton of work. I'm really, really proud of it, Venables. They do storytelling really, really well. And then I didn't download it, but then in the bottom right-hand corner is a shot called Hands I Spot, shot with Martin Tura. Diego Contreras. And so I definitely feel like these types of narrative films are right. They're right the type of work that I love to do. And they're also kind of the hardest work to get produced. I think when I think about my career path and where I want to go next, I look around and not many brands are making these kind of long form, beautiful 60s that, you know, have minimal product in them and feel like real proper emotional stories. And so that's something that worries me as I figure out what to do next and where to go next and where I can continue making this type of work, just because I think that as we shift to a digital world where, you know, brands want to know how to make 6-second spots work, someone like me who really loves those kind of long form emotional horizontal, that's a big conversation every time, because every client wants, you know, their ad shot in vertical. And so you can't really tell like Craig Gillespie to shoot a vertical, because obviously all the filmmakers want to shoot, you know, 16:9. So that's become a kind of a point of tension now. I think, you know, as they try to take this $1 million spot that they produced and you reuse those assets in every single, you know, slot of their media, where some has to be 6 seconds, some has to be vertical, some has to be pre-roll. And so you're kind of picking and choosing what should be consumed as a longer narrative and kind of putting it into these kind of a round hole in a square peg or whatever that saying is. So, and then I'll kind of talk about challenges that I've experienced and talk a little bit about Fellow and just talk, I think, about what you guys can potentially expect getting into the industry, just because I work with a lot of juniors and kind of students getting into advertising, and I'm starting to see a kind of theme, and I can kind of talk about how I feel you can differentiate yourself. So I think the biggest challenges I've experienced are not only the things that have, like, not going to ad school and not really coming from a prestigious company initially, those kind of things all set me back, but I do think, and this is probably a broken record, that, you know, being a woman in the industry is particularly hard, just because, you know, especially at an ocean, there would be Super Bowl meetings where there was 40 people in the room and I was the only female. And I think as much as everyone wants to believe that everyone's treated equally, I just don't think that's the case. And you know, I think especially as we move into a place where brands want more female-focused work, when you have men at the top, you find yourself arguing with them about your observations. Like the year we did Driverless, they really wanted, oh no, I think it was the year after that where I had the agency recommend for Super Bowl. We really wanted to do, we had a spot about a female lead. And you ended up having these conversations where it's like, well, is that what you guys think? Or is that what you guys feel? Or is that right? Or is that the insight? And you end up kind of talking with arguing with your older male creatives where you're like, yes, trust me, I experience this every day. And they're like, I just don't know if that's true. Or they take something really small and like a nuanced insight, and you know, you kind of have to blow that up and make it almost exaggerated so everyone can kind of understand what you're saying. And so I think particularly that notion of brands wanting to advertise towards women, but number one, agencies not having the staff to write those briefs really and kind of judge those insights becomes a big point of tension. And so I find that really frustrating. And I think as I rose, I've definitely been called contentious, moody, emotional, because I speak up and I'm a loud mouth. And so when I also found out that I was being, a few years ago, what led me to develop Fellow, I found out that I was being significantly paid significantly less than my copywriter, who is a guy. And I mean significantly. And I was like, well, I can't just go into my boss's office and say, this is sexist. Like, that's also not the way to handle the situation, because you don't want to come off as aggressive, because, you know, you'll get called emotional. So I really want to talk to a woman, and I didn't really have someone to talk to. And so I went looking for avenues where I could maybe still facilitate those conversations, and I didn't find anything. And I think if you just email someone on LinkedIn and you're like, hey, here's my work history, I have a review next week, what do you think I should ask for? They would be like, this person's an absolute psycho. So I ended up talking with a coworker who was the head of new business at the time, who was a guy, but he knew about business, so I knew I could trust him. And I told him that I thought there could be something for women in advertising that can connect you with other like-minded women who could perhaps act as mentors. It's not quite networking, and it's also not quite like the mentorship where you have to dig out an hour or 2 hours every other week to talk to them over coffee. I thought there was something that kind of did what Tinder had done for dating, for mentoring, where you kind of just take out all of the time and kind of get cut right to the chase. I don't know, I assume. I have been dating since before Tinder came out, so I assume you just cut right to the chase. So I pitched it to Venables in like a proper pitch deck with a business plan, and they ended up giving me the money to do the seed money to build it. And that was 2 years ago, and we launched last November at the 3% conference. And we have a partnership with the One Club, so anyone who's part of the One Club has access to it. I think the biggest challenge with that is I wanted to go through agencies because I wanted to give them a solution to a problem that they started. But it's become quite the bottleneck. And so now I'm thinking of ways that I can open it up and make it for everyone and not just for agencies, because I've just noticed a stall in our growth, and so it doesn't make any sense if no one has access to it. But also, apps are incredibly expensive. So when you write app ideas, when you finally get to an agency, just know that it's like 100 times more expensive than you think it is. Apps are so expensive. Do not do it. Do not have app ideas. I am telling you now, your producer will hate you. And then I think, you know, the challenge is, and I don't know how many people will maybe tell you this, but it's an incredibly clicky industry. It's incredibly clicky. And I think people don't realize how small of a network it is, and how many people hire based on who they know or a friend of a friend. I know that, you know, when I did that internship at Inocean, the other guy in the internship was like the CEO's son's nephew's cousin or whatever. And I see that quite a bit, and it goes all the way up to directors. We almost just shot a spot. Well, I'll touch on that COVID thing where I went to Argentina for a day last month. You know, the director we almost shot with last month was the best, you know, does Christmas with my creative director. And so I think one way that I found to combat that, and this is going to sound maybe dumb or like obvious, but I have been working at my Twitter literally for 5 years, and now I have, I think I have 3,500 followers, which, like, it's not about the followers. It's, I have kind of an online persona, but the connections that has allowed me to make, like, I have made connections with Colleen DeCourcy, who's the global CCO at Wieden, Rebecca Groff, the head of PR at Wieden. Like, those women have now become my confidants through Twitter. And I think the strategy, which is not that, I don't know, unique, is I think I see a lot of people get in there and get into the ad groups on Twitter and try right out the gate to be like, to ask for help or ask for connections. And I think that maybe that can turn people off because, you know, no one wants to be seen as kind of a tool for the other person to advance their career. So I think, honestly, like, kind of build what you think is your online persona. Don't be an overshare, but don't undershare. You know, I think as creative people, like, you almost think, I think of my Twitter as like my brief, you know, what do I want to say today? How do I want to articulate myself? Twitter was one of the reasons I was able to get such a great reception for Fellow. I think I tweeted about needing beta testers when we launched last April, and I got 125 emails in 24 hours. So building up a strong network of ad people on Twitter, it sounds so weird, but I'm even working, one of the girls I mentor, her name's Mary Busby. She's from Alabama. She's trying to get out of the Alabama market. And she's slowly but surely ingratiating herself into ad Twitter. And now she has David Greiner, a senior editor at Adweek, who is helping, you know, he's connecting her to people and mentors and helping her. And so I really think it's about building a brand for yourself online and ingratiating yourself into advertising Twitter, and that will pay off for you in dividends, I think, even later down the line. Like, I've been building my Twitter persona since I was at Anocean. And I have a lot of friends now who say, like, oh, so easy for you. You know, you can't, of course you always get likes because it's this or that, but I've really been working at it and building my tone and, you know, who I want to be, quote unquote, which is not that far, but it's just like funny, empathetic, cares about the right things, you know, willing to help others. And so I think literally creating a little brand for yourself socially has become my biggest weapon, for sure, hands down. I definitely sing those praises in terms of, you know, LinkedIn's great and I think that's good, but what ingratiating myself in ad Twitter has done for my career, I mean, I couldn't be talking to the people that I would be talking to now without that. So I know that sounds kind of silly, but that's my experience. And then COVID, I'll talk about quickly before you guys can ask questions. I think it's still new for us in the industry to kind of figure out, you know, how to proceed. I know a lot of brands are canceling their projects. A lot of agencies are doing layoffs. I think it's going to be a hard time to job search, for sure. And I'm genuinely worried about the trajectory of the industry. So I think that there's valid concerns there in terms of what jobs could look like even in 6 months. I mean, I was job searching before this, and now obviously all of that is on hold. And so I think that's going to be a major part of it, hiring. But at the same time, things like this, being able to reach out to people who maybe you didn't, you know, couldn't before because you didn't live in the same city, but now you have suddenly have the opportunity to do like a Zoom coffee chat with them. I would use this time between now and whenever things get back to normal to really start reaching out, getting into networks, talking to people, making yourself known. Known names and even just recognizable names, I think have a far higher likelihood of being hired than people who are just showing up out of the blue. It's always a friend of a friend of a friend of a connection of someone who met a da 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 da. And I think starting your networking now is probably going to pay off, you know, when the job market hopefully bounces back. I did go to Argentina for one day last month for a shoot. We left March 11th. And by the time we got there, the president of Argentina had put a shelter in place for those traveling from the U.S. So we were like, okay, well, it's not martial law, so let's just get in and get out. And you know, shoot this thing because we needed to shoot at vineyards in the summer, which you have to go to the Southern Hemisphere for. So we were like, oh, well, we can't really come back in 3 days because, you know, the seasons will shift. But things went downhill pretty quickly. Like our DP couldn't fly from Amsterdam, and then the crew started to drop out locally because we were from the States. We were actually stuck with like other agency people in the hotel. So like everyone was like talking about how shitty their projects were going and how everything was collapsing all around us. So literally in like one day, it went from going down to shoot a spot to, I think I was in Argentina for 17 hours and I traveled for 40. So that, and I, there were a lot of other, the other, there was another agency from Ogilvy there who was also leaving that night. So all of the projects that are on hold, I think that's going to be massive. I know everyone is pretty slow right now. And so I also think that brands don't, like no one wants to hear from brands, which I think is a really interesting time. So being able to play your cards right in terms of like, what do you say first? How do you say it? How are you showing up in the world? Are you empathetic? You know, if you say anything that suggests empathy, you're going to have to, people want you to back it up with like a charitable donation. And so it's kind of interesting when I think about the really funny brands like, you know, I don't know, Denny's or whatever, or the really nihilistic brands on Twitter, will that strategy still work in a, you know, economy where people are losing their jobs and people are dying and things are stressful and uncertain. And so I think it'll be kind of difficult for us agency people. What we're going to be tasked with is how do we show up in the world, you know, when everything is kind of going to shit. And I think that that's an incredibly hard task when people don't want to hear from brands. And I think that anything you say could potentially, if you say it perfect, you won't get any credit. And if you say it a little not right, you know, you can have the entire internet against you in a day. And so I think it's a really interesting time to be a brand and to kind of figure out how you're showing up in the world. Even down to your caption on Instagram. Like I see a lot of brands on Twitter right now that are like, when you decide to get out of sweatpants, and you're just like, not today, brand. So I feel like I've ranted quite a bit, 40 minutes worth of ranting. So I feel like we should open it up for questions.
Yeah, sure. Thank you so much. It was very, very insightful into what's happening now for sure. So yeah, let's do some participant questions. I see that Tiara is raising her hand right now. So let me just, bear with me, and then we can unmute you. Okay, there we go. Okay, Tiara, are you ready? I'm gonna unmute you now. Or do you wanna write it in the chat instead? Okay, ooh, I'm gonna unmute you. Excuse me?
Can you hear me?
We can hear you now. We hear you.
You can hear me? Okay. I look a hot mess. That's why the camera is not on, guys. It's here. It's about 1 something in DC. With this COVID, I've seen a lot of different things. And Amazon is actively hiring, but they're hiring on an AWS. And they are looking for people with that background. My background, I just started in the fall, actually, with the Academy. And I'm on my third career move. And it's really exciting for me, but it's been rough due to what's happening and stuff. And going into this field, I'm very excited about it. But I guess my question is, I'm a newbie. You know, my background is retail management up to corporate management and stuff. And when people look at me, they see my resume and they're like, oh, she's in retail. She doesn't know anything, you know, but retail, we wear so many hats. We know how to run a business. You know, I know how to do B2B marketing and all those things. But my challenge right now is the internet marketing, the virtual marketing. How do I get those people to want to buy into me? And I can sell a product, but how do I make them buy into me as well as buy into what I'm selling?
So are you asking like, how are you selling yourself to show up in the world to get jobs? Or are you talking about literally your business?
a little of both, but more so about entering the industry, because it's like you said, is your friend hiring? Do you know anybody in the industry? Where I might be a fresh pair of eyes, I might have fresh ideas, but because of my background, I can't even get a face-to-face time.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
You know, and they're like, oh, sorry, you're doing this, but that's not what we want. We'll keep you on file. And I've had several interviews already, but I feel like it's getting me down because I really want this.
Yeah. I think what I tell people who are trying to get into the industry and who are kind of having a hard time narrowing, you know, getting into those right positions, I think that a few things that I think is really helpful is, if you haven't already, look for the brands and the companies who are doing the work you want to do. Like when you look at my work, it's like very, it's thematic. Like there's clearly a type of work I enjoy doing. And so find the brands and the companies who are doing the work that you aspire to do, and then start to reach out casually to the people who work at those. And maybe, you know, those interactions won't lead to a job at that specific company, but those people who work there know like-minded people and other companies who are doing similar work than them. And I think reaching out to people who are closer to the work that you want to do and ask for conversations, ask for a 15-minute Zoom, building up that network closer into, like I was saying, you know, the exact work you want to get into will help you get closer to those positions, if that makes sense.
It does. It's a lot of information.
Brands and companies you like, go on Twitter, stalk those profiles, reach out to them, ask everyone for a chat, and then be really clear with what you want to get out of those conversations. I have a list someplace from the woman Katie Ramp, who's high up at Matezic Offer, where it's like, know exactly what you want to get out of the conversation, have clear questions. Don't ask the person you're talking to like work too hard or solve a problem for you. And so I think there's a very like structured way you go about asking for help and reaching out to the people who you think would be the most beneficial to your network and to where you want to head. But it's kind of like treating that as rigorously as you would treat job searching, even though you're just reaching out to these people for casual coffee.
I think that's a good point. Having a structured conversation with in and out questions, that's actually a great idea.
And just know that it's going to take a long time. Like when I was searching to go from even an ocean to Venables, I was rejected for a year before I got my job at Venables. So it takes time.
Ouch. Ouch.
Sorry.
I think that's all I had, but thanks for the bit of luck, guys.
Thank you, Tiara. So Frederick also had a question, whether or not what you would recommend starting at a small or like a big agency.
This is my current. So I've been doing a lot of thinking around this. I think for students, it's better to start out someplace smaller, because at these bigger places, you become just kind of a name on a sheet, and I think it's really hard to contribute in ways that help you learn. And I know at a smaller place where you can wear a lot of hats, and you can prove, it's all about when you get in the door, proving as quickly as possible that you're an asset, and showing up with a good attitude and being down for literally anything. I know I made decks at an ocean forever until like 4 o'clock in the morning when no one else wanted to do it. And because I was someplace where that was visible, and people knew that that was happening, that helped me advance and people trust me and kind of people feel bad for you, so they want to give you opportunities. And so I think for getting into the industry, look for those small, really creative, shops. I would say independent, but there's not many these days, but 150 people and under, I think that's kind of the sweet spot where you can get in and make a big impact, because I think the work you do early on kind of sets the tone for, unfortunately, or unless you try really hard to steer the ship, it kind of sets the tone for your career. And so getting in someplace where you can contribute to the type of work you want to make, even if you're not, you know, doing getting opportunities right away. But if you're lending a hand to the type of work that would be applicable to a place like, you know, Droga later on, like I know I went to Venables because I want to work at Wyden, and I went to work on Reebok because I want to work on Nike. And so I kind of looked down the line. Also, Wyden has rejected me 3 times, so TBD. Look down the line and try to see where you want to end up, and then look for the agencies that can help you leapfrog there.
That's a great response. I'm also curious to bounce off of that. Like, your Audi spot, driverless, was very, very well shot, and I can imagine that there were a lot of people involved in that. And like currently, when I've been networking with recruiters, I've received the question like, so what was your role in this? Like, yeah, if you worked on this with a lot of people, what was your role in this? And that's what they want to know. So I'm asking like, what was your role in the Audi commercial as an art director, and how do you demonstrate that in the...
Yeah. I mean, I'm lucky now because I think art directors actually for spots production have larger roles than copywriters, because we initially, there's a lot, so I'm going to try to break down quickly. Initially, when we're selling the spot, I did multiple mood boards of how the future city would look, how the pod would look from scrap, from images from the internet, mood boards of what the casting could be, what the wardrobe could be. And then once you get a director, they supply you a treatment, and that's kind of the vision, their vision. And then once that's approved by the client, I do the concepting for, and this is all approved by the director or edited by the director, but wardrobe for every scene, I do mood boards for those. Makeup for any scene, I do mood boards for those. The house, how the house should be styled, you know, what the set design looks like, picking and choosing pieces that go into his office, and like what that screen looks like, and do you touch it or do you tap it? And then I was funny, I just spoke at a high school, so I have like all of my driverless kind of assets. And then once we start to work with VFX, we basically, me and the VFX team go round and round every day. They do a pass at VFX, and then I screenshot every shot and I mark it up with what needs to be added and what needs to you know, be more refined. And then you do that for 2 weeks. And everything down from the art cards and kerning the art cards to be perfect, which I didn't kern those art cards, so don't look at those. But no, that one in particular was very, very demanding just because the amount of VFX that had to be done. And I basically like was the point person on making sure that that vision came to life. So it was gnarly.
Yeah, that's interesting. So Bella also had a question that said, if you would be able to restart your career in today's climate, what would you have done differently? And is there a certain area within advertising that you see might become the new it thing?
Ooh, gosh. You know, I actually had a dream that I woke up and I was at the beginning of my career and I had to do all the exact same things to get to where I was. And that was a true nightmare. I think I had a lot of luck. I think knowing what I know now, I would be more strategic. I think in terms of like, it's very subtle, but, and I wouldn't say that there are politics, of course, but there's just a certain, I see now how the people act at the beginning and what is, I see what's expected of them from my level now, juniors and people who come in early. And what I would do differently is I would be much, kind of, I think I did things right where it's like I was willing to do whatever it took. I had a good attitude. I was willing to work late. I was willing to do decks. But making sure that people knew I was doing those things. Like, I think I kind of expected for a long time for people to just notice when I was doing a good job. And that is not the case. No one will look out for your career other than you. No one will help you advance other than you. No one will speak up for you other than you. Like, I had a senior art director when I was at InOcean who would email the ECD every time. He was like, he was my mentor, but he would be like, hey, Aisha did this, just so you know, like, you should be aware of the things she's doing to contribute to the department. And now I would be much more vocal about those contributions to ensure I was getting the credit I needed to advance. I think there was a second part to that question, but I can't remember what it was.
So you would every time you do something when you're like working in an agency, you would state to the creative director, I just did this.
It's like subtle, right? Like if I was asked to do something and I send it to the project manager to say that this done, CC your creative director and the person, you know, your creative director and your ACD or whatever. Like it's okay. Not a big deal. Hey, I want credit for this. It's just being visible. Like, don't do anything, just like to be nice and to go unnoticed. And like, when they'll open the deck, maybe they'll notice like how pretty it was, you know?
So, yeah.
Will you go build this deck, come back and be like, hey, I built this deck, but I also saw that it wasn't formatted. So I went through and I made sure all the fonts were the same.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. The second part of the question was, if you believe that there is a certain area within advertising that you see might become the new it thing.
Gosh.
It's a tricky question.
Really tricky question because, a recruiter said this to me recently, which I thought was kind of interesting, which was a few years ago, the hot thing to do was to open a small independent agency. And now that, you know, we've had such turbulent economic times, she thought that people are going to shift back to the McCanns, the Ogilvies, and try to make great work, like try to make those bigger agencies work. For a long time, people thought that you couldn't go to the big networks and make the type of work you want to do because it was so big and there's so many layers. And so a lot of people went indie. But now when we see places like Barton F. Graff go out of business and you're just like, what? And like Anomaly struggling, which I don't know if I think they're still independent. You start to see that it's much harder to survive in those types of times. And so I think maybe it's not like the hot spot, but I think that a lot of people are going to start migrating back to the bigger holding company agencies where it's more secure.
Okay.
It goes against my advice from earlier, but I stand by it. If you can find the right place, go small first.
Yes, we have another question from Creedy. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that right, so sorry for the pronunciation. But what is expected of the juniors when they first start in the industry?
So one thing I always tell juniors is not a lot is expected of you. I mean, I think the two juniors I'm working with right now on a wine brand, they write scripts and stuff, you know, when we're doing that, but they also like help build decks and help put presentations together and do a little bit of the grunt work. And I nodded to this earlier, but I always tell juniors, do your job and then some. If there is a cultural thing at your agency where people want volunteers for X, go do that. Like, go get involved in culture. Go to your ECD with an idea of a pro bono project. Go to your creative director and ask if there's a brief. Like, the best thing you can do as a junior is do your job and then some, and be visible. Being visible, making yourself visible, becoming a part of the culture. Make sure people know you, get to know people. Go to your creative director, ask them to get coffee. Like, people want to help the people they know intimately and have a stake in. And it's not enough to just do your job as a junior. Like, just doing your job will not get you far enough. Like, you need to do your job and then some. And that, like I was saying, that bleeds into culture and that bleeds into being super proactive. Definitely learn to do things without being asked. And I know that's like a hard thing to articulate because it's like, of course, someone gives you a project, but it's kind of what I alluded to with like the deck making when I would have to do pitch decks at an ocean. I would go through and, you know, obviously like, well, no, I wouldn't ask. I would go through and like reformat everything and like, I would improve it within my own bounds. I wasn't like changing people's ideas or whatever. But they expected me to just compile it, but I took it and I improved it, and you know, no one asked me to do that. And so not this sounds dumb, but it's true. Not having to be asked to do your best. I think I get really frustrated with juniors sometimes where I give them a small task and they come back to me in like 10 minutes and I'm like, okay, I literally could have done this. I wanted you to like do it. I want you to do it at, to the best of your abilities. And so using every single opportunity to overperform. And I truly, truly mean every single opportunity. If you think that it can be improved, improve it and just do it and don't ask for permission.
Okay, great response. So we have 2 minutes left now of the time. So I think we might have time for one quick question.
Yeah, I can go a little over too.
Okay. Then we have two. Yeah, we can go a bit over maybe. So the first question is, I have like, are you allowed to do freelance projects while you're working as an art director for Venables?
Legally, I don't. I'm not sure, like, actually, technically. I mean, I guess if they don't find out, maybe. But I haven't, just because I'm so busy. So I don't do actually real freelance, but I do, okay. I do fellow as my side project, which is significant. So I don't have time. I don't have time for freelance.
And Martine also had a question. So I'm going to unmute you now, Martine. There we go.
Okay. Hello. First of all, I just want to say thank you for being here today. And I downloaded the Fellow app a few months ago, actually. And I think it's such a great initiative. Especially for women in the industry. I'm curious about like the issues and trends that you see in an agency. Like sometimes I feel like the way we've learned at school can be pretty traditional, and it would just be interesting to learn about like what trends you see in the agency that you work at.
Trends culturally or trends
like within the advertising agency? Like if there's something new that you use, is TikTok something that's coming? Like,
well, I feel, yeah. I mean, I think, I don't know if I would call this a trend, but I think a challenge that we're seeing in terms of who's at the top, the leadership in place and things like TikTok, like social is moving so fast. And we have people in charge who are in their 50s, and we have a client who wants to appeal to Gen Z women and meet them on their social platforms. And it's become this kind of massive, I think now more than ever before, there's this inequality between who is making the decisions and the type of advertising some clients want you to make. Like, it was never, you know, an ECD could always articulate or understand like what we were doing with the print ad or what we were doing with a TV spot or what we were doing with a billboard. But now it's like, we need a TikTok challenge for Chipotle that is specifically tapping into this dance challenge that was originated here. And it just like fries ECD's brains. And so I think it's not a trend necessarily, but I think people at the top need to learn much faster and almost re-educate themselves on where the status of culture is, because suddenly we have this massive disconnect. Like my ECD judged an influencer category at Cannes, and we like had to give him a presentation on like how to judge it, because he was like, I don't know what the hell to do with this. And so I think right now, now suddenly we have like juniors come in and we're like, come talk to the ECD about like what an influencer is, you know? And I think they're kind of, I would like to see them start to be more interested in educating themselves about all of these other new types of media that suddenly we're, you know, having to create
content. Yeah. Okay, thank you. One last quick question. Sorry?
I said you might be smarter than your ECD about some things is what I'm saying.
I hope so. Let's hope it helps for this, for the future.
So, okay, we have one quick last question. I just have like a very quick question too about...
right now I have nothing to do, so.
Okay, so about like how... we're gonna get in a whirlwind of networking for sure over Zoom. How would you like, what do you think creates character beyond like business and like a personal, gives you a personal relationship to the person you're interviewing? Because you just tapped into that earlier, that you're supposed to like make an impression that's personal and that they want to hire you for who you are.
I would say, and even I'm kind of going through this too, the best, and this is going to sound so cheesy, like it's a live, laugh, love, so I'm just sorry, but it's true, is like being your authentic self and being, whether that's, is more, is better than trying to stay professional. And I think that so many, and I see in my creative directors, like they just have an aversion to like people who come at them too strict. And I think sometimes younger people, in order to be taken seriously, they think they need to like be dressed up and be real. And I'm not saying you shouldn't be precise with what you want to get out of the conversation and your questions, but be calm and be personable and be yourself and be funny. Like I'm even experiencing this. Well, I'll tell you guys because it doesn't matter. But I think one of the biggest reasons I have not gotten hired at Wyden, which I was told, is that when I do my interviews, I'm like too, but I'm too business because I want it so bad. And so I know last time creative director was like, well, tell me a crazy story. And I was just like, I mean, I might as well just leave the room because I have no idea what a crazy story is. And I still don't know what, actually, no. Now I went to Argentina for a day, so I have a crazy story. But the feedback I got was like, they couldn't get to know me. Like they didn't know who I was because I kind of had this guard up. And so I think that the thing that has made even what I've been able to achieve on Twitter is like just enough personality. Like you don't want to be so overtly you that you're like off-putting, you know, like if you, I don't want to be like crazy and weird, but be yourself, be casual, be authentic, be buttoned up, but just talk to people like casually. Like creative directors don't want to feel like you're putting all of their hopes and dreams on them because that stresses them out. And I think that this is all very nuanced in the way I'm trying to describe it. And like, there's no perfect way. And I don't want you to feel like if you don't nail being funny and charismatic and calm and whatever all at once, like that's okay. Like interviewing, you know, it takes time to build up the type of persona of who exactly you want to be and what's the exact right amount of professionalism. But I wouldn't get too caught up in being perfect. I think it's about, you know, being human and being yourself and connecting with people and just talking to them casually and you know, just playing it cool, kind of.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Wojo also had a question. I'm gonna unmute him for because I think that there are some people who have to go, get into class too, so we might have to, let me just unmute Wojo and he can ask his question. Yes, Wojo.
Thanks, Felix. You guys hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. And thank you, Aisha, so much for your insight and the time that you gave us. A quick last question to finish on. What are graduates lacking coming in? What's some one thing, say, that you wish that they were coming in with on day one?
I think, and maybe they just pick it up from the industry, but I think that sometimes graduates can come in jaded, pre-jaded, or, you know, and I see this is going to be kind of shade, but like I see it in VCU graduates a lot where they think they should be treated and get certain projects and be past the point of having to do certain grunt work. And like, no one is immune to grunt work. ECD, like everyone has to do it at some level. And I think that, you know, we've turned a point in advertising where it's just like complaining is exhausting. And like, I don't know. I think sometimes people just come in and they think that they want to fit in and like complain and be jaded with like the higher up people who, you know, have been through the trenches. But like, I think being a source of light and excited and something to breathe fresh air into the industry is kind of desperately needed. And I just don't want people to come in, you know, feeling like they have to hate advertising to be cool, because I think that'll just set you back.
Well, that's a great answer. Thank you so much. That's very helpful. Thank you.
Of course.
All right. Did anyone else? Yeah, great answer to that question. It feels like that is relatable, going to be relatable to us all. Did anyone else have any more questions, or are we going to wrap it up now? Did you have anything else to say? We thank you so much for coming, Aisha. Like, this is,
of course,
I think everyone here is in uncertain situations now with everything going on, and at least I appreciated this so much. Like, yeah, just hearing how you talk about the industry right now and the challenges and the your work at I'm just blown away by your work with like the TV spots you worked on, the directors you worked with. It's amazing. Like, you worked with Craig Leslie. It's so cool. And Wes Anderson too, right?
I was his client. Do you guys understand how wild that is?
Yeah. So crazy. Can't even imagine.
He just didn't talk about what I said. He was like, who's this chick? No. if anyone has any other questions, it might take me a few days to get back to you, but you can always email me. Felix, you can email my email.
Yes. Martine had one last question. And I know that she's a big fan of yours, because she told me about that she downloaded the Fellow app a few days ago too. So here she is.
No, a few months ago, but yeah.
A few months ago, but you told me about it a few days ago.
Yeah,
sorry,
I did. yeah, I'm just like, we're like a bunch of foreign students at the Academy of Arts, and we have the whole visa situation going on. Do you like honestly think that it will be difficult to be hired as a junior and intern like during these times? Everyone's saying like, oh, like it'll be fine, like you have May or whatever, but sometimes I would just feel like I would like an honest answer, because it's like a very stressful period, just because we have like 60 days to find a job from when we get our visa.
Yeah. And, I'm not as deep into the visa stuff, but I think it's challenging for anyone to get a job right now. And I'm not sure how this is, I think agencies are still trying to figure out how it's impacting them and what their next, you know, 3-6 months looks like. And I don't think they know yet. And so I don't want to give you an answer that is like too dark, too bleak. And I also don't want to give you one that's like too hopeful, because I think that I don't think that agencies know quite yet, how they're going to handle this. And so I'm hoping that things will somewhat resume normality in terms of like, you know, internships and things like that. But I just don't think anyone knows at this moment, unfortunately.
Okay. Yeah, because I've just seen a lot of like hiring freezes and internships being canceled. And yeah, it's just, it's a worrying situation. But when you know, or when you hear from someone who works at an agency, like how it looks like from that perspective.
I think it's a scramble still. Like even internally, like I was trying to get a meeting with the partners about Fellow, and they were just like, call us in 3 months. Like I think people are just trying to work out how this looks for their business. And I think that this next month will be a big adapter, because like we have 3 weeks down. I think that we're still working out the kinks. I have a feeling over the next month, people will get more secure in these new systems. And things might come to fruition more, where it's like, all right, now we know what this looks like, or do internships, you know, are they in the fall or whatever. But I think people are still figuring it out, and it's still scattered internally. So yeah. I think maybe the biggest thing you'll encounter is like not getting responses, just because on our end, there's mass confusion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, it feels like it's like, because I talked to a person who worked at Wyden yesterday, and he said that they're more busy now than ever.
Yeah.
Like because they have Facebook as a client.
Oh, yeah.
And like Facebook wants to do so much stuff. So I can imagine that it's like mostly, or what he said too, is that they don't know what to do. Like no one knows how to handle the situation, but they have a lot of work.
Or like, you know, looking at places that you think could potentially grow, like right out of the gate. I know Shopify, they do a little bit of advertising and they're growing like crazy. I work right next to the recruiter, or live right next to the recruiter at Shopify, not for for engineering. And then I know Twitch is in San Francisco and they have a creative department. So it's like maybe just thinking about those types of companies that you think at this time. Like Venables, don't apply to Venables right now. We're very confused. We don't know what we're doing. very traditional media. So we're looking, you know, how we invest in this new world order. But places that are really social or really digital, maybe those are places you go first when you start to job hunt, because they have a better grasp on, and even their clients. Like I would look at the client list or Google or places locally in San Francisco. I think maybe we could potentially be the best place to be, since there's so many, you know, internet-based companies here. Might be the place to look first before you go to traditional agencies.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you so much, Aisha and Martin, for that great question. Yes, I think, thank you for extending also. It's been 15 minutes past, but I think we needed it. Some assurance and confidence.
I have one last question for you, Aisha. Would it be okay if students requested connections on LinkedIn?
Oh yeah, for sure.
Okay, so we will post your LinkedIn profile if that's okay.
Yeah, that's totally fine. And like I said, it might take me a few days to get back to you, but I'm pretty good about responding. I like to be thorough, so if you're waiting, just know that I am waiting so I have time to respond.